This video is to allow you to correct your homework for section 4.2.2. So first of all, on graph paper, you are supposed to draw the axes, decide on a scale, and plot points to represent this data. And then you're answering the question, does the data appear to be proportional? Why or why not? So the first thing you need to do is to graph this data. If it were me, I would first probably put it in order. I just think it makes it a little bit easier to graph it, but you don't have to. So what you I should see is that you have put down some type of scale along the bottom, maybe just going by ones along the bottom up to 9. And then on the vertical scale, you could go by 3 1/15 hundredths if you wanted to. And then the next one would be 6 3/10. And then the next one after that would be 9 45 hundredths. Or you could just go by 3s. 3, 6, 9, 12, 15. Either way, you have to get up past the 28 1/3 hundredths. And the advantage to doing the 3 1/15 hundredths as your scale is that these numbers are all going to be multiples of that. The advantage to just going with 3, 6, 9, it's going to be easier to mark those numbers, and you just need to approximate these values. So basically, 1 at the horizontal should line up with 3 1/15 hundredths at the vertical. 2 on the horizontal should line up with 6 3/10 on the vertical. 3 will not have a point. 4 will not have a point. 5 on the horizontal would line up with 15 75 hundredths. 6 on the horizontal lining up with 18 9/10. 7 will not have a point. 8 will not, and 9 would line up with 28 1/3 hundredths. So make sure you have some type of title. In this case, they're not really giving you a very clear one. So maybe you'll just say quantities at the top, and quantity X would be your horizontal label. Quantity Y would be your vertical label. But again, you do need to have this graphed. Then does this data appear to be proportional? And you should say yes, because the graph is a line that does go through 0, 0, and all the Y values are 3 1/15 hundredths times the x values. So what happens is, again, for something to be proportional, it has to go through 0, 0, or that we could see it would go through 0, 0, and the y values have to have a constant multiplier from the x values. And in this case, that multiplier is 3 1/15 hundredths. So again, do the graph as well. For this one, we're looking at probability, and we also have to write our answers as fraction, percent, and decimal. So the first thing you should do is add up the number of marbles, and what you end up finding is there are 10 marbles. So the probability of brown would be 4/10, which we would then simplify by dividing top and bottom by 2 to 2/5. 4/10 we know is the decimal, 4/10. You could also get that by dividing 2 divided by 5 or 4 divided by 10. And we know 4/10 as a percentage is 40%. Then for green, it would be 3 green marbles out of 10, which cannot be simplified. 3/10 as a decimal, 30% as a percentage. Red would be 2/10. You can divide both top and bottom by 2 and get 1/5. You get 2/10 as a decimal, 20%. And purple, 1/10. Which of course is this decimal and this percentage. If you've done it right, the percentage should add up, of course, to 100%. Then we have this next one. They want you to explain the sequence and find the length of the unknown trick. So let's start with A here. We know that the value of X plus itself plus itself plus itself has to equal 12. So in other words, 4 X lengths have to equal 12. Well, then that means X would have to equal 3. As far as explaining the sequence, we would just say that this acrobat is repeating a trick 4 times to cross that 12-foot tightrope. Because again, that's what we're seeing in our diagram. And then here, we see that, we see that he is the acrobat. Again, it could be a guy or gal, I guess. But he is going to be going ahead and doing a trick 4 times, and then walking another 3 feet. And then on the way back, he is doing the trick 1 time, and then walking 21 feet. So what we know is this trick is repeated 4 times, going another 3 feet, and then the other direction, you could say 21 feet first and then doing the trick. The order doesn't matter. But what we find is the value has to be 6. Now, how do we know the value is 6? Well, one thing you could do is to look at removing one of the tricks from both the, you know, the way there and the way back. And we could also look at removing 3 feet from the way there and the way back. So what that would mean is now 3 of these R values would equal 21 minus 3, or 18. So therefore, R would have to equal 6. Now, at this point, you could also still reason that out or do a guess and test, but this would be probably a good process or way to think about it. Here, you have to identify the property, operation, or idea that justifies going from one line to the next, and then find the value. So what we have here is 7 times 2 plus 4 minus 2 times, in parentheses, 7 plus 3. And when we look at what the next line says, well, what has occurred? The 2 has been multiplied by the 7. That's what we're seeing here. And then the 2 is being multiplied by the 3. That's what we're seeing here. So we know that is called the distributive property. So when you take that number in front and you distribute it to the numbers inside, and by distributing, we mean multiplying by those, that is called the distributive property. Then we look at this line to the next line. We still have the 7 times 2. We still have 2 times 7, which is the same as 7 times 2. Order's changed a little bit there. But we've also changed the order by moving the plus 4 into a different location. So again, remember, whenever the order changes, we call that the commutative property. Specifically, the commutative property of multiplication is coming from changing the order of 2 times 7 to 7 times 2, and the commutative property of addition is being shown by changing the plus 4 to this location to this location. And then they want a final answer. So 7 times 2 minus 7 times 2, of course that will basically zero itself out, 14 minus 14, plus 4 minus 6. 4 minus 6 would give us negative 2 for a final answer. Here we are starting with this line, and now we're going here. Well, what did they do to go from the first line to the second? They multiplied 6 times 3, they multiplied 3 times 4, and that's how they got those. So that was just multiplication, or we call it multiplying the terms. Now to go from the second line to the third, we've switched the order. We had minus 8 here, now it's here. Plus 12 was in the middle, and now it's at the end. So when we change the order, that's the commutative property. And again, that's commutative property of addition in this case, because these are adding and subtracting. And remember, we can think of subtracting as adding a negative. Then we have 18 minus 8, which is 10. 10 plus 12 would be 22. Here, what did we do to go from this first line to the second? Well, we had 3 to the second power, that's still there. We had 5 times 1 minus 3, and what we see is 1 minus 3 would be negative 2, they've moved it to over here. And then we had 4 times 5 plus 1, and they've moved it to here. So again, the order has changed, which is commutative property, and specifically commutative property of addition. They also did the subtraction of the 1 minus 3 to get the negative 2, but property-wise, it would be this. Then what did they do to go from this line to this line? 3 to the second power is 9, 4 times 5 is 20, plus 1, 5 times negative 2 is plus a negative 10 or minus 10, and that's just multiplying those terms. 9 plus 20 is 29, plus 1 is 30, minus 10 is 20. Here, we have 8 plus negative 12 plus 10 plus 2. We still have 8 plus negative 12 plus 10 plus 2, but we've changed where we placed the parentheses. Here it was around this, now it's around this. So when we change what's being grouped together, that's the associative property, specifically associative property of addition. Again, you might say, well, there's some subtraction, but subtraction is adding a negative. So Negative 12 plus 10 plus 2 would basically be 0. 8 plus 0 would be 8. And then for this one, they want you to write three different sentences that could describe the relationship between these quantities, $27 and $81. So you could say $27 is one-third of $81. Because if you multiplied 27 times 3, you'd get 81. You could say $81 is $54 more than $27. Because if you added 54 and 27, you'd get 81. You could say $27 is $54 less than $81. You could say 81 is 3 times $27. You only need three different sentences, so you don't need all four. And if you've come up with something else and you think that it is also an acceptable answer, please let me know and I can help you out with that.